Let's just do a very quick recap. This was written after Paul's first missionary journey. He heard the news that they'd all rolled over to wrong doctrine, so he's writing to them. And points 4, 5, 6, and 7 are the ecclesias in Galatia, Antioch, Iconium, Lystra, and Derbe. All right, at this time, Paul's sick as a dog. He's dead on his feet. This was the catch cry of the Judaizers, the teachers from Jerusalem that wanted to restrict believers to the law. Acts 15, verse 1 is the background to Galatians. Their catch cry was, unless you are circumcised, you cannot be saved. No ifs, buts, and maybes. Paul presented Christ as Jesus, a crucified one, which we read in that reading. Thanks, Brad. Tonight, verse 1, Galatians 3, verse 1, evidently set forth among you, means placarded. And what was placarded was the total rejection of anything human, anything flesh originated. No flesh will glory in his presence. I'm not going to dwell on these very, very much because we've covered them. And we saw how Jesus Christ represented both man and God. He represented human weakness and divine strength. He represented the principles of weakness and the principles of strength. He showed what the cause of sin was, flesh, and the secrets to righteousness. He showed the ways of death and the ways of triumph over death. He showed the flesh and he showed the word. And you always see those two sides in Jesus Christ on the cross, representing man and representing God. Okay, so just as a bit of a further background, the Judaizers taught that human nature had the capacity to attain unto salvation by doing your best to keep divine law, and that would be able to please God, and that would be the basis of salvation. Now, the Judaizers, we met Judas the Judaizer last time and a few times. Let me just see if I've got his photo. Here he is. He's Judas the Judaizer. Now, he had very specious arguments. What does specious mean? Specious means they're misleadingly attractive. Arguments that are so clever, they even fooled. Does anyone remember who they fooled? They even fooled Peter and Barnabas. They got caught up in the dissimulation, the hypocrisy, Galatians 2, verse 19. So, of course, if Paul, being a pillar of the ecclesia, Galatians 2, verse 9, was fooled, what hope did new Gentile converts have against these very clever arguments who had no background, no Sunday school, no upbringing or education in the truth? So the allegations that were made against Paul were that he only preached half the gospel. He missed out on a major portion of the gospel. What was the other half? Well, the other half was that it was necessary to obey God by keeping the law of Moses. And they would say, well, that's God's will, isn't it? God's law is God's will. Doesn't God want you to do his will? So you've got to keep it. And so Judas the Judaizer and the other Judaizers would have set forth Jesus not as a crucified one, but as a champion of the human race, a champion of the Jewish race, who was able to show that by an addiction to law-keeping, with the added advantage of human goodness, that could please God. And Judas the Judaizer would say that Jesus showed the perfection of these inherent natural qualities that God had inbuilt into man when he created him in the image and likeness of God at the beginning. And all you needed was an addiction or a dedication to law keeping, and that would do the trick. That would get you over the line. So what did they teach as the basis of salvation? They taught that you, by your own sincere, yes, they were sincere, determined efforts of the flesh can please God. But what does God say about glory of the flesh? 1 Corinthians 1, verse 29. that no flesh should glory in his presence. You see, it sounds so right, doesn't it? It sounds so right that if you really put your effort into it and addict yourself to keeping law, that you can please God. Sounds so right. And God wants you to put in some effort. Yes, we would agree with that, but not as the basis of salvation. So the Judaizers taught that the Sabbaths and circumcision and new moons and all those ceremonial things, they were an exercise in obedience. And when you obey the law, what do you have? You have a satisfaction and a spiritual glow because you have done something. You have done something to please God, supposedly. So really, Judaism is really flesh in religious activity in the truth. And when flesh takes over our worship, it's never going to go right. It's always going to be unacceptable. And they would have pushed Abraham as the ultimate example of a law keeper, that you have to become a son of Abraham. So if you're a Gentile, you're not naturally a son of Abraham, but you can become a son of Abraham through circumcision. You can become a proselyte, and then you can become within the national constitution of Israel. And that was by keeping the law. So they taught that the law gives eternal life. They would have quoted Leviticus 18, verse 5, that was quoted in the chapter tonight, that the man that doeth them and shall live in them. So they claimed that Jesus came to show this, that by perfect obedience to the law, that the grave could not hold him. And they taught the blessing to Abraham is eternal life, and that it came by keeping the law. So you see how clever these arguments are, and you would wonder how you would go against their own arguments. And some of us are new in the truth. Some of us have come into the truth without the education that people born into Christadelphian families have. And maybe some of us wouldn't know how to answer Judas the Judaizer if we were in the Galatian ecclesias. So we got up to verse 6 last class. So let's just go back a step to verse 5. And what he's saying there is that God that supplies you the Spirit and worketh miracles, does he do it because you've done works of law or because you believed a report? So where does that expression come from? A believed report. Who hath believed their report? Where does that come from? That's Isaiah 53, verse 1. Who hath believed their report? So he's in that territory, isn't he? He's expounding Isaiah 53 to the Galatians. It's a rhetorical question. Who hath believed their report? It's the same as in verse 2. The hearing of faith is the same expression, a believed report. You see, it's about belief. It's not law keeping because the law can't give you for the forgiveness of sins. So in verse 6, well, so verse 5, he says, what you believed in was this. You believed in a crucified Messiah. You believed that the flesh was weak, and you believed that it was God's influence, not your own efforts of the flesh, that would please God, that God would influence you to become more and more like him. So Galatians 3, verse 6, it says, even as Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. And they loved Abraham. Paul loved Abraham too. He was a mutual test case. He was a test case for both sides of this argument. And he's saying, you obviously received approval when you came to the truth, Galatians, because you received the Holy Spirit amongst you. And this is because of the things you believed in. Verse 5, you believed in a crucified Messiah, the flesh was weak, and you believed in God's influence. Well, how was Abraham made righteous? Was it by law keeping? No. Even as Abraham, or just like Abraham. Abraham was made righteous not by law, but by faith. Abraham believed God and it was counted to him for righteousness. Where's he citing from? He's citing from Genesis 15, verse 6. And you think of Abraham back then in Genesis 15, verse 6, he was very old, and neither he or his wife had had a baby. God had promised him great and precious promises, but he knew that those promises required a physical seed from Abraham. And in chapter 15, verse 1, he received a vision from God. And he says to God, "Will you give me, what will you give me, seeing I have no children?" Here's Eliezer, my servant, Eliezer of Damascus. You haven't given me any seed. Is Eliezer going to be my seed? And he says in Galatians, God says to Abraham in Genesis 15, verse 4, no, it's not going to be Eliezer. I want you to understand, Abraham, it's going to be your very literal physical descendant. You're actually going to be involved. The expression in verse 4 is, this seed shall come forth out of thine own bowels. That's going to be your heir. So he brings him forward. It says in Genesis 15, verse 5, he brought him forth abroad and said, look at the stars, look at the heavens, try and count the number of stars if you're able to. And he says, look, Abraham, that's how big your seed is going to be. So shall thy seed be. And you can imagine poor old Abraham. Here he was, he's old. He's around about 84 or 85 years old, and he's losing his virility. He's losing his ability to produce a child. But he comes out and he looks at the stars and he hears the word of God and he believes it. Despite the fact he's old, despite the fact that he's losing his ability to father a child, he believed that he would be a father. He believed what God had said, and he believed that God was able also to perform what he said. So this is what he believed, Galatians 3, verse 6. When it says he believed God, he believed that his own body was incapable of producing the seed. It was weak and mortal, and he believed in God's power. He believed that God's power would be mighty to effect the promise. Did it happen straight away? No, it didn't happen straight away. Apparently, he had to wait more time. And at the appropriate time, the seed would come. And it would be a seed based upon divine working, not upon human contribution. So he believed Yahweh, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. So he was imputed, he was deemed to be righteous because of his faith. He wasn't really righteous on his own. He'd sinned. He was a sinner, just like all of us. But he was deemed or accounted or imputed righteous by faith, by his belief, not by works of law. So he understood his own inherent incapability. He was unable to produce the seed. He knew this. And he believed in God's dynamic capability. And the very belief of the fact of those two facts, it was imputed to him for righteousness because of that. And he believed God right from when he was called, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. And this is expounded in detail in Romans chapter 4. Now, you can go to Romans chapter 4 and verse 17 if you like, but we're going to have the slides on the screen anyway. So, Romans 4, verse 17. It says that, as it's written, Abraham, I've made thee a father of many nations, even him whom he believed, even before God, in God's presence, he believed even God who quickeneth the dead. So this is Abraham. He was dead. His body was dead by this stage. He couldn't produce a seed, but he knew that God makes alive the dead, and he calls those things which be not as though they were. And though the seed hadn't been developed yet, he said to Abraham, despite that, to thee and to thy seed will I give this land for an everlasting possession. Verse 18, Romans 4, verse 18. And Abraham, against hope, that is beyond hope, believed in hope that he would become the father of many nations. And to become the father of many nations, he knew that there had to be a physical seed, a literal seed, a physical seed from him, and that all nations might be drawn to the faith of Abraham. Now, notice Verse 19. Notice his faith, Abraham's faith, and the emphasis upon human weakness and divine strength in verse 19. I'll just look that up for you and read that. Romans 4, verse 19. And being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body now dead when he was about 100 years old. So he's older now than he was in Genesis 15. He was about 100 years old, neither the dead yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. They're both dead. They're both incapable. Now, earlier to this, in chapter 16 of Genesis, they're sort of waiting and waiting and waiting for this seed to come along. It doesn't come along. And they get together and they think, do we really need to contribute to producing this seed? Maybe we need to make a contribution to God's promise. Perhaps God is calling upon us to use our initiative. So Sarah says, well, you take Hagar. I'm barren. My time's past. You take Hagar. So they take Hagar. And God hadn't told them to do that. But they thought perhaps God wants their initiative. Perhaps he wants us to make some real contribution of ourselves after all. So they take Hagar. And Ishmael was born, and he was a child of the flesh, wasn't he? So Abraham and Sarah's contribution to producing the seed was an absolutely complete failure. Right? He was a larrikin, just like his mother. And it was obvious that their contribution was a failure. He wasn't a godly person. And we have those dramatic incidents in Genesis where God comes and visits them. Visits Abraham again and says, out of your bowels, Abraham. And he says, let Ishmael live forever. And he tells Abraham, no, it's not going to be Ishmael. It's not Ishmael. And Paul in Romans says, by this time, Abraham couldn't any longer have kids himself. He'd finished. 13 years before, in his dying virility, he was able to cause a seed to be conceived by Hagar. But 13 years later, he'd had it. He's dead. As far as producing children goes, he's dead. He's too old. And he was just as dead as Sarah as far as conception was concerned. Well, Romans 4:19 says, and being not weak in faith or belief, he considered not his own body now dead. His body was dead. He was 100 now. And he considered neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. Because of belief, because of faith. And so now, when he realizes he can not make a contribution at all, he realizes Sarah cannot make a contribution at all. At this point, God's ready to act. God didn't want a fleshly contribution. And Abraham proved to be a great man of faith. But in developing Abraham's faith, what did God teach? He taught that salvation doesn't come through human contribution. Salvation is on the basis of faith. And we need to recognize human weakness and our own human incapability of pleasing God. And Abraham had to realize he was incapable of producing the seed of promise. So God was prepared to work when they were both dead, and not a minute before. When they knew they were both dead, that's when God's happy to come in and his right arm brings salvation. So no one could ever mistake that the seed developed out of Abraham was not a product of his own abilities, but a product of divine power. Romans 4, verse 20 says he staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief or lack of faith. But he was made strong in the faith, giving glory to God and being fully persuaded that what he had promised, he was able also to perform. And that's not easy to do in trying circumstances. And we wonder how we go sometimes in trying circumstances. But Abraham did believe that what God promised, he was able also to perform. And Romans 4, verse 22 says, therefore, because of that, it was imputed to him for righteousness. Interestingly, Romans 4, verse 23 says, now it was not written for his sake alone. Now that means it's written for our sakes. This is an encouragement to us that when everything goes wrong in our life, when we're totally incapable of fixing situations ourselves, God is prepared to act. God is always with us. So it was imputed to him for righteousness. So it was written for us also, to whom it shall be imputed righteousness, if we believe on God that raised up or developed this seed of promise out of a dead body, Abraham, and a dead body in the ground, Jesus Christ. He raised up seed of our Lord Jesus Christ from the dead. So Abraham becomes the example of one that was developed out of the dead, out of Abraham. Romans 4, verse 25. This is what it's really, really teaching us. He was delivered for our offenses. He suffered and died to crucify the flesh. Jesus was to be associated with sin. He was to be identified with sinners so that men could confess their weakness and their inherent physical evil and declare that God is right and just in making man mortal because of sin. And so Jesus was delivered as a basis of human confession of human impotence, just like Abraham, unable to do it himself. And Jesus was raised again for our justification. And on that basis, the grave couldn't hold him, not because of law keeping, because the word resided in him, which was the eternal thing in Jesus, because the power of God had produced perfect obedience, not an addiction to law. And so we're set forth those two principles: human weakness against the divine power to produce righteousness. And Paul's saying that is exactly the same belief as Abraham. Abraham acknowledged his own human weakness, his inability to produce a seed or contribute to the promises of God, and it was only through divine power that he was imputed righteousness. So for Abraham, his own experience in begetting a seed means he understood Christ. He saw Christ's day. He learned by his personal experience that the principles that would be in the sacrifice of Christ were these two principles: human weakness and divine power. And so when Abraham offered up Isaac, he told Isaac, "The Lord will provide. God will provide the offering." Even if it happens to be Isaac, God is working in the offering. God's doing it. God's offering it. We're not making any contribution. We've just received the benefit. And so there was this intimate connection in the Galatians being imputed righteous because of a belief in a crucified Messiah, which was exactly the same as Abraham believing God to produce a seed in him. That's why Paul picks on him. And that's why he says in Galatians 3, verse 6, even as faithful Abraham. In other words, Abraham's exactly the same as you are. You believed in the same principles. They both accepted human weakness and they both accepted divine strength as the only way to salvation. And Judas did not like that. This cut right across Judaism. This is the opposite to Judaism. Judas taught that you, by your own sincere, determined efforts of the flesh, can please God. So this cut right across Judaism. And so, having quoted that wonderful verse back in Genesis 15, verse 6, now he capitalizes it in Galatians 3, verse 7. And Abraham was approved on exactly the same principle of faith and not works. So, verse 7, Abraham's approved, you're approved on exactly the same basis. Abraham's justified or is imputed righteous, you're justified or imputed righteous on exactly the same basis. Abraham's now acceptable in God's sight, you're acceptable in God's sight on exactly the same basis. What was that basis? Faith or belief, not works of law as Judas the Judaizer tried to teach. So Galatians 3, verse 7 He's saying, take note, therefore, they which are of faith, or that's that word is ek of, is ek out of, the Greek word ek, out of faith. Those who are developed out of faith, the same are not children, but sons of Abraham. You know, the Jews have always raved on about, oh, we have Abraham to our father. Now, what that means is we are Abraham's sons. And Paul's saying natural birth doesn't mean anything in becoming a son of Abraham. It's having the same belief, the same faith as Abraham. It's the only thing that counts for you to become a son of Abraham. So Galatians 3, verse 8. He starts off that verse and the scripture. Why does he start that verse with and? Well, what he's saying is this is consistent with all the other scriptures in the Old Testament. Galatians 3, verse 8, and the scripture foreseeing that God would justify the nations, that is what it should be, not the heathens, and they're not just some nations, it's all nations. We're talking about Jews and Gentiles now. The scripture foreseeing that God would justify the nations through faith, or that is on the basis of faith, just like believing Abraham, preached before the gospel unto Abraham and said, or as it was written, in thee, Abraham, shall all nations be blessed. Now, Paul's placed a big emphasis on this word blessed here. And the line of his argument is that the scripture foresaw that God would justify or make people approved, not on the basis of law, but on the basis of faith. Hang on, where am I up to here? Galatians 3, verse 8. God would justify the nations on a basis of faith. That's Genesis 12, verse 3. In thee shall all nations be blessed. So they're synonymous terms. That God would justify the nations on the basis of faith is the same as saying, Genesis 12, verse 3, in thee shall all nations be blessed. And it quotes that in that verse, end of verse 8. It's quoting Genesis 12, it's citing Genesis 12, verse 3. So what does this word bless mean? What does bless involve? What does this word blessing really have behind it? Well, firstly, Acts 3, verse 26. Now, I'll just read it to you. Verse 25, he's saying, look, you Jews, you are the children of the prophets and of the covenant which God made with our fathers, saying unto Abraham, and he cites Genesis 12, verse 3, and in thy seed shall all the kindreds of the earth be blessed. Then he goes on to explain what that means in verse 26, Acts 3, verse 26. Unto you first, God, having raised up his son Jesus, sent him to bless you. How? How are you going to get blessed? In turning every one of you away from his iniquities. Now we call that repentance, don't we? Turning away is repentance. Turning away from your iniquities is repenting about the past, looking at the past with remorse and contrition, and looking to the future with commitment, hope, and faith. So verse 26 is really saying that you are one of the nations or kindreds of the earth, and that the blessing involves turning away from your iniquities. That's the first part of the blessing. It's a blessing to be able to repent. Now, Romans 4 also mentions this same word blessed, and it also cites Genesis 12, verse 3. Romans 4, verse 7, David declares the blessing when he says, blessed is the man unto whom the Lord will not impute sin, Romans 4, verse 6. That involves covering of sins, turning away from iniquities, covering from sin. Look at what we're getting just from that one word, blessed, covering from sin. And this is what Paul expected them in Galatia to get out of that word, blessed. He didn't expound it very much, that word. You know, they'd only been in the truth a little while, but he expected them to get that out of the word. So, in other words, you know, we asked, what does this blessing involve? Well, blessing involves atonement and eternal life. The two principal blessings, atonement and eternal life. Psalm 133, for there Yahweh commanded the blessing. It's like The blessing is shorthand for the promise to Abraham. And what is the blessing? Even life forevermore. So you see, when you have repentance, Acts 3:26, forgiveness or justification, Galatians 3 verse 8, and Romans 4 verse 6 and 7, and Psalm 133 verse 3, you have atonement and eternal life. That is the promise to Abraham. That is what Abraham was promised. And that is what the Galatians were being promised, not because of works of law, but because of belief, the same belief as Abraham. So, we use that verse 8, Galatians 3, verse 8. We use that word, that verse a lot when we're taking people through for baptism. And we say that that's God making people righteous or justifying people through faith. But the reason that Paul put it there is not just to lecture people on first principles. He's putting it there because it's the answer to the Judaizers' false claim that you can please God and that can, and by law keeping, and that law keeping can be the basis of salvation when it can't be. The gospel was preached to Abraham. That's what Galatians 3 verse 8 says. The scripture foreseeing that God would justify the nations through faith preached beforehand the gospel to Abraham. Abraham understood what it meant. Otherwise, God wouldn't have forgiven him. Abraham saw my day and was glad, Jesus says. He understood the principles of sacrifice, and it was cemented in his life by his own experience. And the blessing of covering of sin and eternal life was to come to all nations. So the question is, if that's how God operated in Abraham's life, and if that's what God promised Abraham, atonement and eternal life for all nations, are there two ways to eternal life? Is there a Judaistic way and is there an Abrahamic way? Or is it the same way? Well, it's in Abraham. That's the point. There's not two ways. There's not a different way for the Jew and there's not a different way for the Gentile. God is one. And because God is one, there's only one way to eternal life. And there must be, therefore, one basis of eternal life. And what's that basis? On the screen, in Abraham. That's the basis of eternal life. And in Abraham means to have the same faith as Abraham. So to get eternal life, what do you have to be? You have to be righteous. There's no one unrighteous is going to inherit the kingdom. You have to be made righteous. How do you get to be righteous? Not by your own efforts, but by being imputed righteous by God. And the rest will be imputed by God. That's what atonement is, isn't it? It's covering your sins and being imputed righteous where you have no righteousness of your own. And even when you're finished, even when what have you attained? It's all been done by God. You haven't made much of a contribution at all. That's what Abraham and Sarah had to realize. God doesn't want your contribution. He's going to do the work here. And Christ's righteousness will be imputed unto us. What's it on the basis of? It's on the basis of Abraham being the embodiment of justification by faith, not works of law. So God set him forth as a man. He set him forth to the nations for all to see, like Christ. It was set on the cross. Abraham was set forth as a man, experienced in life by a lot of trouble, but he had to have faith. And he was set forth as a righteous man, and he became a great example of faith, the embodiment of faith. He was a man of faith, and he was approved by God on that basis, faith, not works of law. And he was justified because of it. So, to be in Abraham, what is it to be in Abraham? It's to identify and to agree with the same principle of justification by faith, not by law. The way you believe and the things you believe and the approval that was given you was the way of eternal life. It's saying, I'll stand with Abraham. I will bless him and I'll be blessed by him. And it means that your identification with the principles of justification by faith, as it says there on the screen, and identification with the promises that were promised on that basis. That's what it means to be an Abraham, to agree with the way that Abraham was justified by faith, not his own effort. So that in thee, Abraham, shall all nations receive atonement and eternal life on the basis of faith and justification by faith, as was exhibited in this man, Jesus Christ. And this is what makes you sons of Abraham, children of Abraham. Not, oh, we have Abraham to our father, not natural birth. And this is the same for Christ. You know, Christ has children. Think of these verses, Hebrews 2, verse 13. You know, Hebrews 2, 14, for as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death. Well, this is the previous verse. So this is a crucifixion scenario. And it says, behold, I and the children God hath given me. And it's like, is this out of context or what? What's Jesus all of a sudden thinking about children? Well, this will produce children. His crucifixion will produce children. And in that same verse, Hebrews 2:14, it says, and again, I will put my trust in thee. Trust, trust, belief, faith. I will believe in you. See, it's the same basis for Abraham. It's the same basis for Jesus. It's the same basis for us. And Isaiah 53, yet he shall see his seed, that's his children. He was cut off, and who shall declare his generation? That's his children. Yet he shall see his seed. Jesus will have children. And that's what he says in Hebrews 2:13. God gave him children. Now look at this one. This is beautiful. This is Isaiah, Psalm 45, verse 16. Psalm 45 is a messianic psalm. It's the psalm that, I think, just let me check. I think Psalm 45 is the one that says, thy throne, O Elohim, is forever and ever. Let me just double check that. I think that's the right psalm, but it's messianic anyway. So take my word for it. Ha ha ha. Yeah. In verse 6, Psalm 45, verse 6, thy throne, O Elohim, is forever and ever. So it's a messianic psalm. Now you've got this really cryptic, like, unusual verse in verse 16. Instead of thy fathers shall be thy children, and he'll make them princes in the earth. So instead of thy fathers, it's a psalm that's addressed to Jesus. So it's saying, Jesus, instead of your fathers, they're going to be your children. So who were Jesus' fathers? Well, Jesus' fathers are people like Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, David, Hezekiah, people of faith like that. So instead of being thy fathers, Jesus, they're going to become your children. And we all have to become children of Jesus. These are the children, he says, behold, I am the children that God hath given me. They're the same children. Now, this is the gospel. This is what the gospel is all about. We become Christ's children through baptism, and we're able to believe the things concerning the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ because of this. So that means Abraham was a begotten son of God. He was a child of Christ because of his acceptance of what Christ stood for, because of his acceptance that there would be a Christ who would set forth these principles. And he would set forth the principles of human weakness and divine strength. And Abraham would believe them, and he would agree with them. And he would believe that Christ died, Christ would die as an atonement for sin. And Abraham saw that, and he was generated into a son of God because he saw a crucified Messiah. And therefore, he became a spiritual child of Christ. And it's exactly the same for us. We have to become a spiritual child of Christ. So Abraham believed that salvation is based on faith, and trust in God. The Judaizers were teaching the opposite. Abraham had to come to acknowledge the rejection of human ability to achieve God's purpose and the divine strength to obey and comply, rather than your own determined will of the flesh. So, Galatians 3, verse 9, and we'll end here. Galatians 3, verse 9 says, So then, they which be of faith are blessed with faithful Abraham or believing Abraham. They are generated ek, out of faith. You become a child of Abraham, you become in Abraham, you become a child of Christ by being developed or generated out of faith. And once you've done that, you can be blessed with faithful Abraham or faith in believing Abraham. And the blessing that we've looked at tonight is repentance, forgiveness, and everlasting life, which is atonement and eternal life. That's what Abraham was promised, and that's what Abraham will receive because of faith, but nothing to do with the works of law and nothing to do with human achievement.